This is Dr. Martin's supplemental lecture on chapter 23. This is section 4 that I'm going to be talking about. This is a group that's called the Platyhelminthes, or phylum Platyhelminthes. These are referred to, well, as characteristics or features. They're generally referred to as the flatworms for obvious reasons. There's a number of phyla that are worm-like in structure, which means that they're long and thin and kind of maybe taper at one end or the other or both. In this particular group, they are flat. Their body is flattened along one dimension. This group includes some free-living forms. An example is the planaria, or planarians. But they also include some parasitic forms. And that includes probably a group that you've heard of before, and that's if you have pets anyway. That's the tapeworms. It also includes some parasites that are called flukes that you may not have heard of. One of the interesting things about this group is that we have some advancement in body form or structure. And let me, I'm going to maybe erase these two, so this will be characteristic 3. So body form advancements. We actually do have 3 tissue layers. And so this is considered an advancement. The 3 layers are actually shown here. This is the body form of the planaria. And if you were to take a section through that body and look at cross section, you would see 3 different areas of tissues. And so in this diagram, here's the digestive system. And this layer of green cells is called the endoderm, E-N-D-O-D-E-R-M. And this is a layer that always surrounds the digestive system. The outermost layer here, the shown in blue, is called the ectoderm. And it is a layer that gives rise or becomes part of the skin as well as part of the nervous system. And then lastly, the middle layer here that's shown in red is a layer that we call the mesoderm. So meso meaning middle. And this is a layer that in organisms gives rise to muscle, and then in higher organisms, bone. So ectoderm, skin, and the nervous system. Endoderm, the digestive system. These terms actually refer to layers of the embryo. Those same terms can be applied to the adult, but most often we talk about the differentiated tissue or the final product. A second advancement here is that we now have bilateral symmetry. In other words, we have right and left halves if we take the animal and cut it along this axis. This is different from radial symmetry. Radial symmetry, if we have, say, a jellyfish whose tentacles coming out, we can cut along a number of different axes, and we're always going to have symmetrical halves. But in bilateral, there's, again, a right and left half. It's not a radial type of organization. In addition, we have a head area and a tail. All right, some other features of this group here. We'll go on for feature number four. When we talk about digestion, the digestive system is very highly branched. And in this illustration, as well as what's in your textbook under figure 23-9, you can see what I've drawn in here that represents the digestive system, at this point it's called the gastrovascular cavity. One thing still about the digestive system is it still only has one entrance that serves as both mouth and anus. And in the planaria, that structure actually protrudes from the undersurface. It just looks like a tube. And that tube is somewhat muscular, and it will suck up material into the digestive system, and that material will be digested, but the waste products have to be, will exit through that same opening. There are, so this is point number five, we do have a nervous system. I haven't illustrated too much of that here. We do have two eye spots that are sensitive to light. We have neurons toward the anterior or the front of the organism. And so up in this region, we'll have some nerve clusters. In addition, these two flaps do have sensory function. And they appear to be associated with olfaction or smell. Okay, your textbook shows a picture of a tapeworm, and also a little bit about the life cycle of the flukes that I'd like to briefly mention. So this is going to be point six, I believe. So this is specifically about the flukes. So these are parasitic organisms. There's several types that can infect humans. One of them is called a blood fluke, and it causes a disease called schistosomiasis. And it has somewhat complex life cycle. because it involves two hosts that are very different species. And as you can see from the diagram, 23-10, part of this life cycle involves being a parasite in a snail. And then the other part of his life cycle involves the human host. And there's certainly parts of the world where these parasites are rather prevalent. Okay, that's the end of section four. I will talk about some of the other organisms in chapter 23 on Tuesday. And then we will probably on Thursday I'll record some more lectures where we'll actually look at the arthropods.